So you need to be an effective advocate for your person. You just keep pressing your point.
You are listening to The Alzheimer's Podcast with Mike Good of Togetherness, your number one resource for practical tips and insights, empowering you and your family to live well with Alzheimer's. Hello and welcome to episode 40 of The Alzheimer's Podcast. I'm Mike Good of Togetherness. As always, thank you for joining me for another podcast where my goal is always to empower you to maintain a positive experience, reduce and eliminate the need for medications, and make your time together with those you care for the best it can be. In this episode of Navigating Rough Terrain with the Dementia Sherpa, Christy Turner and I will continue our conversation on how to know when it's time to intervene or get professional help. This is the fifth episode in this six-part series. If you've missed the prior episodes, you can catch up by starting with episode 36, where we kicked off the series with an overview of five main areas to look at. Today, we're going to discuss how to know when physical changes require intervention or professional help. I am so pleased to have Christy Turner, the Dementia Sherpa, as a regular guest here on the Alzheimer's Podcast. She provides a level of knowledge, empathy, and compassion that's unrivaled and that I believe you will find very helpful and refreshing. She is a certified dementia practitioner, certified dementia care unit manager, and cognitive stimulation instructor. She has run award-winning memory care communities in assisted living and skilled nursing levels of care. Using her 16 years of experience and working with over 1,100 people living with dementia and their families, she's developed a system that helps families move from crisis management to confidence. Well, hello, Christy. It's great to have you back on the Alzheimer's Podcast to continue our series on knowing the signs of when it's time to intervene or get help.
Thanks so much for having me back. I love being here. I feel like it's my second home.
Well, Christy, before we start discussing physical changes that might be clues that intervention is needed, how about a quick recap for our audience of why this is such an important topic?
Well, I think everything related to dementia is important, of course. That's why I'm the Dementia Sherpa. But specific to this series is it's really tough for families to figure out, when is it time for intervention? Should I be offering help, or should I just chill out? And nobody really likes conflict. And then when you're dealing with dementia, or what you think could be dementia, and starting to see things, it's really easy to convince yourself that it's all in your head and that the worst isn't true. And obviously, safety has to be a priority for people living with dementia. And there's just, I think this series was just a great way to figure out what is a five-alarm fire and maybe what's not, and to give people some tips on what to do if they're seeing some of these signs, and to let them know, yes, these things that we're talking about do have a relation to dementia and are worthy of attention.
Those are all good points, and I believe we talked about before how as professionals, it's easy for us to just start thinking, oh, everybody knows all this, but then we got to remind ourselves that there's 27,000 new caregivers every day worldwide that the majority of which don't know anything about dementia, and what they do know, a lot of times there are misconceptions. So I just really love that we're doing this series, because I just think it is so important to share this with our listeners.
Yeah, I think we've had pretty good feedback so far. So I think it is resonating. And that is such a great point, because of course, I think everybody knows it. And I often will apologize to people. I'm sorry, I've said this a million times before. You know what? Nobody has ever said, Christy, please stop repeating yourself.
that's so true. So your article on physical changes starts out by saying physical changes are often overlooked or not associated with signs of dementia because we tend to think of physical changes as age-related only. Can you elaborate on that a bit?
Sure. So I think most of us know that it's certainly not unheard of for elderly people to have falls or have more illnesses, need to go to the doctor more, that type of thing. We kind of expect that as people are getting toward the end of their life. But a lot of times, because it's happening toward the end of somebody's life, we erroneously think, oh, it's just what happens when you get to a certain age. And a lot of it can be dementia related. And that's why it's important to know that. One of the things I say a lot is, you know, dementia isn't a cure for, and then fill in the blank. So, you know, it's not a cure for feelings. People with dementia still have feelings. And likewise, dementia is not a cure for any other condition, right? So just because somebody has dementia doesn't mean that they don't still have this heart problem they've had for 15 years or diabetes or whatever other condition may also already be present.
Right, that's true. And you mentioned falls, and falls is definitely as a professional, I think we're all accustomed to having fall prevention be a major point of emphasis. And you did put it on the first item on your list, but the average family member probably isn't aware of the consequences that a fall can have. How about explaining that to our listeners a little bit?
Sure. So the consequences of a fall can, to be very blunt and cut straight to the chase, the worst consequence is death. And this is one of those things that I remember, you know, years ago before I was involved in this profession, I had heard that people died of a hip fracture, but it never made sense to me because I didn't hear of people dying of a femur fracture or a humerus fracture, or, you know, any other type of fracture. So I was like, maybe with the exception of a skull fracture. So what was it about a hip fracture? I didn't get it.
Right. Same here.
And what it is it's that hinge, right, that allows us to sit upright. And if we can't do that, then fluid can collect in our lungs, pneumonia, death. And so that's one of those things. But in the context where we're talking about dementia and falls being related, although we do focus, I think, rightly on fall prevention, one of the things that we miss is that a fall is often a sign that something is wrong. It's a symptom that something is wrong. It's not the problem itself. So, for example, one of the things that people living with dementia are often put on is a class of medications called antipsychotics. And I won't get on my soapbox too much about that, but never, it should never be used. There are double black box warnings from the FDA over 10 years old saying people living with dementia should not use antipsychotics. People over age 65 should not use antipsychotics because all of the harm it does. Okay, so that's one thing. But here's one of the ways that it can cause harm. So people can get very lightheaded because their blood pressure can drop significantly when they go from a position in bed to sitting up or from sitting up to standing. And that precipitous drop in blood pressure, especially from a sit to stand, can lead to a fall. Boom. There you go. So that's a really significant bad outcome that, of course, can be, you know, avoided in that one way, not using those medications. But there are other problems too, like with Parkinson's disease, with dementia, or dementia with Lewy bodies, or Alzheimer's disease, where the person's gait, like how they walk and their balance, can be significantly affected, which again can lead to a fall.
That's so true. And one thing about when we're young, and we stumble or start to fall, we're a lot more agile and can recover quicker. And I've noticed, right, even with myself, I'm not quite as quick as I used to be, and I shouldn't be trying to put my pants on in the morning standing up, because when I miss that pant leg, I stumble and start to fall. And
right.
And so it's, you know, that's part of it too, is just not being able to recover quickly. And there are several things that we can do, right, to help prevent or avoid falls.
Yeah, and those are some of the kind of basic ones that I have in the article, like remove throw rugs and runners to assist with preventing falls. And it's funny because I can't count how many homes I've been in where I was doing an assessment. Part of it is the safety assessment and telling, you know, okay, need to remove the runner from the hallway or the throw rug here. And people are like, really? But I really like it.
Right.
Okay, let me clarify the choice for you. Is how it looks more important than what could happen as a result of it being there? And I think we become so acclimated to our environment that a lot of times we miss things, and because they just kind of become part of the scenery. And honestly, you know, when I'm recommending remove this rug, that rug, people have that moment, and then usually they tell me later, like, you know, I didn't really, I mean, that thing's just been part of the scenery for so long. It was just a shock to hear somebody say it needs to be gone, but it's really not that big a deal.
Right. And as a dementia care partner, in order to help make our homes more dementia friendly, we definitely have to make those sacrifices and prioritize what's really important to us.
Yeah, definitely. And I think when you look at it in that light, when you're able to shift your perception 15 degrees and go, oh, yeah, it's just a rug. Who cares? You know, that's my person staying upright, not ending up with a hip fracture, not having to go through surgery, not having to go through rehab, not risking pneumonia. That becomes very easy.
Other things you can do, you can add lighting. People think about how, you know, you add lighting, you add motion sensors, occupancy sensors for at night, because falls and trips happen at night when we can't see. We tend to be able to walk through our homes in the dark, but as we age and lose our ability of spatial awareness, I believe there's a real technical term for it, but I never can remember
Visual spatial impairment definitely happens with dementia, particularly dementia with Lewy bodies and Alzheimer's disease, and just having those. I love the motion sensor nightlights because they're not going to keep someone from sleeping, right? Because right. They only turn on when there's motion. So that's really helpful. Also, and then, you know, something that we typically don't think about very much, but let's say you have one of those lift recliners. And for people who may not know what that is, it's a recliner where if you hit the remote control on it, it brings the seat up. So it, instead of how you think of a recliner where your head is back and right, so it's in an upright position, then you hit the remote and it lifts so that a person comes into a standing position. So it helps people who aren't able to get out of a chair on their own. It helps them be able to do that because it brings them to a standing position. And we think, this is fantastic, right? What a great invention. And physical therapists freaking hate them. And the reason why is because now it's not forcing those muscles to work, right?
Okay.
So people start becoming what's called deconditioned because now they're not going through. If you think of it now, you know, while you're listening, not if you're driving, but if you're at home while you're listening, you know, sit in a chair that has an arm on either side and then slowly go through the motion of standing up. And pay attention to those muscles you're using. That's a pretty significant amount of muscle groups that you wouldn't be using if your chair just magically brought you to an upright position. And so then what can happen is if somebody doesn't have their walker right in front of them, ready to go, they can get real wobbly and end up right back against the chair, right? But that's a threat of a fall. Or they do have their walker in front of them. They start moving forward, but their legs just aren't as strong as they used to be because over this period of time of using that chair, they've become deconditioned. So that's another thing to look at and weigh pretty carefully.
Deconditioning, that goes back to the point you made, how our hips are the hinge between our upper and lower bodies. And once we've become injured and we've lost mobility, like such from a fall and a hip fracture, it tends to be a downward spiral if we're, you know, not very proactive in rehab and helping our loved ones rehab.
Right, exactly. And that's another great point. And here is a big pro tip. If your loved one is, you know, if you're going to make that decision that they are going, that you're going to go ahead and move forward with surgery, and it could be hip surgery, it could be knee replacement, whatever it is, and they have cognitive impairment, understand that when you're moving forward with that surgery, you are also making a commitment that you are going to be 100% involved in the rehab process. Because I promise you, it's not going to work unless you make that commitment and follow through on it. The reason why is because physical therapy builds on the gains that you've made the previous session. You know, if the PT patient is someone who is cognitively impaired, the PT is going to end up spending some time kind of going back through what was already done. And the other principle as far as why PT works is because you do your session with the therapist, and then there's stuff you're supposed to do between sessions. They give you exercises or, you know, motions that you need to go through in order to be ready for your next session and continue getting benefit from that first session where they gave you the homework. It's not something that you can kind of, you know, BS your way through. The work actually has to be put in. Now, again, when we're talking about a person living with cognitive impairment, how are they going to remember to do these things? And it, again, we start talking about all the complex processes involved in doing simple everyday things that we take for granted. But for a person who's cognitively impaired, it becomes, you know, akin to rocket science. There's a lot of steps and they need to be sequential and timely and all of those things. So they definitely need a trusted person who can shepherd them through that process, be their coach, be their cheerleader, be their taskmaster, juggle all those balls, those roles, and get them through that process. Otherwise, you do end up with a situation where you're wondering, was this even worth it? Should we have moved forward with this surgery? Because now it seems like my person is worse off than they were before all of this happened. So it's, you have to be really vigilant and very committed to that rehab process. And I'm glad you brought that up, Mike.
That self-discipline, I think almost everyone would agree, is where we all probably fail in when we try to go on a diet or we try to start a new workout regimen. Having self-discipline without somebody there next to us helping motivate us is really, really tough.
Right. And that's for those of us without cognitive impairment. Another great point.
Exactly.
You know, if we think about it for ourselves, we know it's pretty challenging. So it's always, anything that's challenging for us is just that much more challenging for our person.
So the next item on your list, and I believe this is an item that affects families greatly and often leads to the family looking for more help and maybe moving their loved one to, say, a memory care, is changes in sleep patterns and that disrupted sleep pattern. Because when a loved one's not sleeping, it's affecting the care partners and the family as well, right? So.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, and you start off there in that section of your article talking about how sleep medication should not be used for older adults and especially those people with cognitive impairment.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely right. So it's those prescription medications as well as Tylenol PM, Advil PM, Excedrin PM, anything with PM, right? Nitol, and Benadryl. I know some people still use Benadryl. Benadryl should never be used for people living with dementia in any form, not for allergies, not for sleeping, not for calming, none of that. It is really detrimental. All of those medications cause significant confusion.
Okay.
And we know for ourselves, we can feel like we have a hangover after taking any of those types of medications. So again, imagine what it's like for a person living with dementia. It's just a no-go. Melatonin, some people have had really good success with it. Some people don't. You know, it's probably worth trying. But, you know, I link to another article I have that has a bunch of ideas for what you can do to get your person into a good sleep cycle. And those things are probably worth trying before anything else.
that would include things such as, for example, keeping your loved one active during the day.
Right. Again, just like us, you know, if you're not tired, if you're not sleepy, it's hard to fall asleep.
Right.
So, yeah. And if you've been doing nothing but laying around on the couch all day or sitting in a chair, you know, not really doing anything, you may be bored. You may feel kind of like low energy, but that doesn't mean you're sleepy. And for people living with dementia, especially when they get to that point where they can't hold on to a thought long enough to carry it through to a meaningful action, a lot of times they will be in a chair and the TV's on. And the family will say something to me along the lines of, well, I can't get him to do anything. He just sits there like a bump on a log. And what the family is mistaking for apathy or lack of interest is actually the person not being able to hang on to a thought long enough to act independently to do something. So that's where somebody needs a lot of intervention from a helper, where they have somebody who's encouraging them, who's guiding them, who's showing them things to do. So, and having a good structure to the day is really helpful, because there is that balance between we want our person to burn through their energy during the day so they sleep well at night, but we don't want them to be so overwhelmed with stuff to do and stimulation that then they get into kind of a completely overwhelmed mode and have a catastrophic reaction, which is commonly called sundowning. And that will keep everybody up for quite some time before that's over too. So that's another detriment to sleep.
In our show notes at togetherinthis.com/episode 40, I'll provide links to all the different kinds of resources that Christy's mentioning to help deal with sleep and sundowning and all. Another item on your list is sudden incontinence and urinary tract infections. And you say that UTIs, or urinary tract infections, have different symptoms in older adults and cognitively impaired people than they do in others. I'm unfamiliar with this. Can you elaborate on that a little bit for our audience?
So for somebody your age, my age, our age, we're in our 40s. So
sorry, for me anyway, I'm just speaking for myself.
No, I'll take the barely too. It's wrong, but what the heck. So our symptoms would be painful, burning urination.
Okay.
Bladder spasms, which are extremely painful, and increased frequency. Like bladder is spasming, which is making you want to go, and there won't be very much that comes out, but it'll burn like nobody's business as it comes out. Oh. That's how you know you have an infection, right? Bad. And you may have a fever too, and just kind of generally feel like, meh. For a person living with dementia, a cognitively impaired person, the symptoms are going to be, number one, they're not going to complain about the pain from a spasming bladder. They're not going to tell you it burns when they urinate. You may notice if they're already incontinent, you may notice that they're seem to be wet every time you need to help them change Depends. Or you may notice if they're still using underwear that when you're doing the laundry, like, something seems wrong. But I'm talking like usually there's not a ton of urination happening. What you will notice though is your normally very sweet mom is ugly. She gets mean. She is completely out of sorts. Her personality is like Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde. Things have just gone completely off the rails. You know, of course, people living with dementia have moments of confusion, right? But I'm talking about sudden onset, kaboom, confused. Like, completely disoriented. Where am I? What's going on? It's a dramatic change. So any sudden change in anything, whether we're talking about people who are cognitively impaired or not, any sudden dramatic change for anybody, you seek medical attention there, because that is a sign things are not as they should be, right? But again, particularly for people living with dementia, you need to seek medical attention, because it's just an untreated infection will, you know, it can lead to sepsis, and that, again, can lead to death. So this is really, really big deal, and often we don't think of it as the big deal it really is, because a UTI for somebody in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s is no great shakes. You go to the doctor, you get antibiotic, and call it good. It's irritating. It doesn't feel good, but it's not the end of the world. For an older adult, particularly an older adult with cognitive impairment, it can be life-threatening.
So in a care home, that such as you've managed in the past, is it fairly easy for the staff to test for a UTI?
I wish.
Okay.
So, unfortunately, here's how it usually shakes down.
Uh-oh.
So the staff will pretty accurate, you know, an experienced staff will pretty accurately diagnose the UTI based on changes in mood and behavior. Like, I think they have a UTI. So then there's something called a hat that goes in the toilet, and it's not like a hat you would wear on your head, but that's so you can catch a sample.
Okay.
The problem is typically a lab wants a clean catch, right?
Okay.
But, you know, we do the best that we can. So sometimes it might take a few times before we can actually get that clean catch. Then we can dip it and go, yeah, okay, this looks likely, and call the doctor. Other situation, depending on where somebody lives and, you know, what that living situation is and the level of care, may need to go to the doctor. Probably 99 times out of 100, because the change in mood and behavior is so quick, the staff will catch it, will say, you know, okay, this needs to be treated. They'll do a UA, and guess what? It comes back negative, and the doctor says, there's no UTI. Labs came back negative. Okay, so we wait 3 more days through ever increasing confusion, massive mood change, massive change in behavior. Go ahead, do the repeat UA, and guess what? They have a UTI.
Oh.
Yep. So what I encourage families to do, because to my mind, that's 3 days of unnecessary suffering.
For everyone, right?
So, yeah. So here's what I tell families to do. And I probably link to it somewhere in here. But I have a little guide called Talking to Professionals. And it has a template in the back for doctor appointments. And you can do this whether you have that or not, right? So keep a notebook for every, like, one central notebook. You take it to every appointment, whether it's eye doctor, dentist, PCP, whatever. You take that notebook to every single appointment. And so you can always refer back. And then when you start seeing signs of change, you start writing those symptoms down and you let the doctor know. And you may have a bad first experience with this. You may go through the process that I already described, right? But the next time it happens, you go back, you look in your book and go, yep, these are exactly the same symptoms. And then you let the doctor know that.
Okay.
Yeah, I know it says negative, but here, these are exactly the same symptoms. And again, you may have a bad second experience. The third time, they should be taking you seriously. And one of the things that people who aren't from, like, the medical profession or don't have a lot of exposure to the medical profession is families can feel kind of intimidated in a medical setting or, well, the doctor said, and especially for older adults, a lot of times they were raised to think that the doctor was basically akin to God, and that's just not so. So you need to be an effective advocate for your person. You just keep pressing your point. No, this is completely consistent with what we've seen before. And I'm going to need you to do something about it because this is not normal. And trust me when I tell you, you know 100% more about your person. You are the expert. You know 100% more than any professional involved in the situation. So I probably know more about dementia than you do, but that will never replace your knowledge of your person. So you know how they usually act, what their mood usually is, what's normal for them. When you see a dramatic change, that needs to be taken seriously, but you're going to have to be the one to communicate that message.
Great advice for our listeners, Christy, as always. So as we wrap up today's episode, do you have any final advice you'd like to give our listeners about clues and physical changes that might require intervention?
You know, I would direct people over the post because there are several pieces of it that we didn't have time to discuss today, and just really encourage people to be that advocate for your person and don't let professionals intimidate you. Again, you are the expert in your person and they need you. They need you to be that advocate for them, to be their voice, and you can do it. I have faith in you. I'm rooting for you. And if you need help, of course, you know, reach out, but you can do this and it's important that you do.
That's great, Christy. I do appreciate you once again joining us and sharing your series on knowing the signs of when it's time to intervene with the Together in This or the Alzheimer's podcast listeners.
Thank you so much.
And I look forward to completing our series. Well, I don't look forward to completing it, but I look forward to talking with you next week on part 6 of our series on cognitive changes.
Sounds good.
So goodbye now.
Bye.
This does conclude our conversation with Christy Turner, the Dementia Sherpa, right here on the Alzheimer's Podcast, your number one source for practical tips and insights. This is the 5th episode in this 6-part series, so if you've missed the prior episodes, you can catch up by starting with episode 36, where we kicked off the series with an overview of 5 main areas to look at. And I hope you come back next week for our final conversation on this topic, where we will discuss knowing when cognitive changes require intervention or professional help. So be sure to visit the show notes at togetherinthis.com/episode40 for any mentioned resources and for a link to Christy's website. You've been listening to The Alzheimer's Podcast with Mike Good of Togetherinthis. For more information and to get the resources mentioned in this episode, visit togetherinthis.com/podcast.